see you for a long time.
Thank you.
example of Father Michael of the parish here, a very warm welcome to all the members of St. Joseph's, especially the workers of the charity and everyone who works there. Let me ask you all to be seated, and if you prefer to be seated for the rest of our service as we continue to work.
So let us light the torch of Centenary Committee. For Lillian and Rob will now light the torch. So as it says in the hymn, all are welcome in this place. Those of you physically in the building, and those of you joining via the webcam, welcome. How lucky are we? Thank you for your presence, Archbishop Cushley, and your fellow priests, with Father Paul representing our presenting brothers. What a joy to be celebrating 100 years of service. Initially, the Daughters of Charity were invited into the diocese by the Archbishop of St. Andrew's at Edinburgh. So how fitting it is that you are here in person, the Archbishop, to honour your predecessors and to acknowledge the great work of St. Joseph's over the century. Welcome to all our friends, sisters, staff, people we support. St. Joseph's is not what it was, but it has responded to the signs of the times and adapted, and perhaps over the next 100 years, maybe not so much, it will be entirely different yet again. It is a privilege to be counted among those who have lived and worked in St. Joseph's. I feel blessed and honoured to be able to welcome you. Our thanks and gratitude are extended to Rob and the present staff for organising this massive Thanksgiving, and to all who have been involved. In a few moments, in fact a month, the opening pageant will look at St. Joseph's lived values through its developing history. And so, without further ado, Colette will narrate our story. Thank you.
Individual
is just one example of the value that is made. which can be all St. Joseph's and all it has been over the past 100 years. Today's strap line says, St. Joseph's is a service where a person matters. Thank you, John and Michael. The reality that a person matters is evident in everything that St. Joseph's Services believes in. This is highlighted in the choices open to each individual person St. Joseph supports. The value of choice is a foundational value. As early as the 1940s, people we support could choose to go on trips and holidays. And in actual fact, a group went to Lourdes in the 1940s and have since made many return trips. However, many of the people we support have had holidays all over the world when staff accompanied them. Thank you to Margaret and Lucy. St. Joseph's began supporting people in the community in the 1960s, and long before the 1990 Community Care Act, choices were common for the people in St. Joseph's. This is followed by independent choices of today's housing support services, with people having choice and control over their lives. The people are supported to be as independent as possible, deciding on what they do, if they would like to volunteer, take risks, meet up with family and friends, or go to the pub for a pint. The 1940s also saw St. Joseph's create a contract with Lothian Health Board. No longer was St. Joseph's just a standalone service run by the Daughters of Charity. It was recognised by the NHS as a place of excellence to be offered to those who would benefit from the love, care and friendship offered. Thank you, Sue, Corin and Helen. This was carried on with St. Joseph's tradition, transition to social care from the 1990s, and our relationships with local authorities, particularly Midlothian Council. Inclusion is a value we cherish, no one is left out, and the creation in 2012 of the Board of Advisors, composed of 10 people supported by St. Joseph's, speaks of the importance of this value. All are welcomed, and their gifts and skills are celebrated. Gifts, talent are abound throughout the story of St. Joseph's. The value of skills will always be a sign of St. Joseph's determination to offer on the very best services. This can be seen from its history. In 1947, the General Nursing Council approved St. Joseph's Hospital to train nurses. In 1969, St. Joseph's opened a special school to teach both children who lived in St. Joseph's and day people. In 1996, John Rutherford, who many will remember fondly as Jockey, was awarded a BME. In 2018, Alan McKenzie was elected chair of the National Involvement Network. Thank you to Donna and Norman for bringing this value. We see the skills and talents of the people we support every day, from their jobs to their volunteering, both in and out of St. Joseph's, and their contribution to the community. Anyone coming through the door of St. Joseph's, whether it was the big wooden door of St. Joseph's Hospital, the glass door at Sycamore House, or the front door of the homes of the people we support, we know that friendship is a value that can be seen everywhere. Thank you, Margaret and Max. Friendship is a value that encompasses all the previous values of trust, respect, choice, inclusion, and skills. One of the greatest moments of friendship came for St. Joseph's in 1982, when the now Saint Pope John Paul II came to visit St. Joseph's Hospital as part of his visit to the UK. The Catholic Church in Scotland recognised the great work and spirit of St. Joseph's and chose St. Joseph's to be the place the Pope would visit. St. Joseph's, in its own simple and humble way, extended the hand of friendship to the Pope, who in return offered his hand of friendship to St. Joseph's. In 2016, so impressed with the work of the Board of Advisors following her visit to St. Joseph's to celebrate her status as a living wage employer, the then First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon, invited the Board of Advisors for lunch to the Scottish Parliament, and what a great day was had by all. Anyone who has experienced St. Joseph's as a person who is supported, a family member, a member of staff, a visitor, or even just a neighbour experiencing the friendship, warmth and love that is St. Joseph's. As we celebrate our 100 years of love and service, a service that started with four daughters of charity who trusted in the guidance of the Holy Spirit, we place the next 100 years of service into the hands of the same Holy Spirit, assured that the continued guidance will move forward with hope here at St. Joseph's, where the person really matters. Thank you, Alistair and Mark.
From the second book of Samuel. The word of the Lord came to Nathan, God, and tell my servant David, thus the Lord speaks, when your days are ended and you are laid to rest with your ancestors, I will preserve the offspring of your body after you and make his sovereignty secure. It is he who shall build a house for my name, and I will make his royal thrones secure forever. I will be a father to him, and he a son to me. Your house and sovereignty will always stand secure before me, and your throne be established forever. The word of the Lord.
The response to the psalm is, his dynasty shall last forever.
His dynasty shall last forever.
I will sing forever of your love, O Lord. Through all ages my mouth will proclaim your truth. Of this I am sure, that your love lasts forever, that your truth is firmly established as the heavens.
His dynasty shall last forever.
I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to David my servant. I will establish your dynasty forever and set up your throne through all ages.
His dynasty shall last forever.
He will say to me, you are my father, my God, the rock who saves me. I will keep my love for him always. With him my covenant will last.
His dynasty shall last forever.
The second reading is a reading from St. Paul's letter to the Romans. The promise of inheriting the world was not made to Abraham and his descendants on account of any law, but on account of the righteousness which consists in faith. That is why what fulfills the promise depends on faith, so that it may be a free gift and be available to all of Abraham's descendants, not only those who belong to the law, but also those who belong to the faith of Abraham, who is father of us all. As Scripture says, I have made you the ancestor of many nations. Abraham is our father in the eyes of God, in whom he puts his faith, and who brings the dead to life and calls into being what does not exist. Though it seemed Abraham's hope could not be fulfilled, he hoped and he believed. And through doing so, he did become the father of many nations, exactly as he had been promised. Your descendants will be as many as the stars. This was the faith that was considered as justifying him. The word of the Lord. And let's say the gospel acclamation together. Glory and praise to you, O Christ. They are happy with heaven.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jacob was the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary. Before was born Jesus, who is called Christ. This is how Jesus Christ came to be born. His mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph. But before they came to live together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a man of honor and wanting to spare her publicity, decided to divorce her informally. He had made up his mind to do this when the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because she has conceived what is in her by the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you must name him Jesus, because he is the one who is to save his people from their sins. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had told him to do. The Gospel of the Lord.
As soon as we arrived here this morning, I began meeting person after person, all of whom were filled with happiness and excitement, because everybody was here to celebrate their birthday. As you get the years past, we don't put as much emphasis on our birthdays. But today, there's no escaping the fact this is a hugely special birthday. Everybody is involved. And we celebrate today with a sense of thanksgiving. Thanksgiving to God, and thanksgiving to all those generations of people who've been associated with this extraordinary place of love and care. Choosing a name is a hugely important thing for a young child, or for a project, or a business. I used to live in Nigeria, and I knew a couple there, and they were telling me way back, before Nigeria became independent, the Queen was due to visit Nigeria, state visit. And there was a lot of excitement everywhere, and posters, and flags, and all sorts of noise. But as it turned out, this couple, they were expecting their first child. And the child was born on the very day that the Queen came. And the father absolutely insisted on how the child should be remembered, how his name should be. He said, "My child is to be known as Eze Nyawandu," which basically means, "This is my queen," even though in fact the child was a boy. So naming a child is hugely important. People are concerned when naming a child, naming a project, naming a business. I've been at meetings where people are trying to choose names for charities. We've discussed for quite some time about the latest charitable work of the Daughters of Charity in the city of Glasgow, and all sorts of different possibilities were suggested. This is something very, very good. Sometimes charities are concerned, we want a name that will attract people to support us financially. We want a name that the government will respect, that we're doing something for the social care of the people, and the government will take notice of it. But when this charity began, this work of service and care began, right from the start, they chose a name, St. Joseph. In choosing the name, they were not just choosing a name, they were choosing also a patron, a heavenly patron, a protector, somebody to care, somebody to intercede for them and care for them. So St. Joseph. There are many other possibilities they might have chosen, but he was the one, and I stayed with them. Now St. Joseph is known to us all, but very interestingly, he's one of the few people in the center of the story of Jesus of Nazareth, and we don't know a single word that he spoke. It's not a word of his recorded. We have the words of Mary, of Elizabeth, of the apostles, but not a single John the Baptist, not a single word from St. Joseph. And there's something very powerful in that, because in proclaiming our love and support of Christ, we don't depend on words and slogans. We live it and show it in our lives. And that's exactly what Joseph did. The story of Joseph begins really in a very dramatic situation. He was engaged to Mary, a young woman from Nazareth, and before they came to live together, he found her to be with child. And he was shocked and afraid, upset, and he thought about it for long. He was a good man, because he knew this could end up with Mary being charged and even being executed. He decided the best thing is quietly to end my plan to spend my life with this woman. He decided to divorce her in a way that she would be saved from all the hardship and nastiness that would have followed. But the Lord spoke to him in a dream. And very extraordinarily, Joseph immediately accepted the call of the Lord. "Don't be afraid," he was told, "don't be afraid. Mary, choose her as your wife, because the Lord is with her. And we're told straight away, after his dream, he took Mary to be his wife. And that's the first of four dreams that Joseph had. Four direct personal messages from the Lord. The next thing we hear about him was when the whole population was time, it's time to have a census, a counting of the peoples. And they were all told to go to their place of origin. If you're from the north of the country and living in the south, go back to where you were born, and that's where you must register yourself. And Joseph had to make a journey to the city of David, Bethlehem, in order to take part in the census. And he was there, and the town was full of people, all who had come because the census was taking place. And Mary was very close to expecting the child, and they could find no place for them to stay. And I often think of the terrible embarrassment and upset that Joseph must have experienced at that time to provide for his wife expecting the first child and a good place to offer her hospitality or care. He ended up in the outbuilding of what might have been a little hotel. And the child was born there in real poverty and just cared for as the poor village people would have cared for their child. That was the second thing. The third thing that happened and related to Joseph was, you know, when the wise men came from the east looking for the newborn king. And Herod heard about this and he was quite determined to get eye on the king. And he was determined to get rid of this newborn king. And he planned to have to kill the child. And to do so, he was prepared to kill any small boys from that area so that he could eliminate the new king. The Lord spoke to Joseph again, and he was told, take the child and the mother and bring them to safety. And that very night, not waiting for the dawn to come, he led them away, and they ended up in Egypt, and he was told to stay there as long as King Herod ruled at all. They lived in Egypt as refugees, as asylum seekers. There would have been a community of his own people that lived there, but they were outsiders, and God knows what sort of accommodation they had there. But they stayed there until again the Lord spoke to him and said, take the child back, for the one who wanted to kill him is now dead. And the final message was, don't go to the big city, don't go to Jerusalem, take him away to some small, quiet, remote place. Not necessarily Rosewell, but the place he chose was back to Nazareth, a small village. And he lived there, and he cared for the child and his mother. He was a carpenter, probably a tradesman, going to the villages and the houses around about, repairing doors, fitting windows, not like today, new kitchens and so on. He provided for the Son of God. He provided for Mary. He trained Jesus in the skill of building and carpentry work, buying and selling. And that was Joseph, all the time, caring, caring, caring. His whole life was about caring and protecting Mary and her divine child, the newborn child, Jesus. We hear what happened to him. They used to go, Joseph and Mary, used to go down to Jerusalem for the big feast day. And when Jesus was a small boy, we regard him as a small boy, 12 or 13, but he was already a bar mitzvah. And he was already a little adult boy. And he had the right to come and read in the synagogue. And he said, I'm going with you to Jerusalem. And not only that, but he stayed behind after his parents made their journey home. And we know how he was found. They were so upset. 3 days later, they found him in the temple, speaking to the people, speaking to the teachers of the law, and asking them questions, and providing all sorts of ideas to them. He went home, and he remained subject to them in the village of Nazareth. At some point before Jesus began his public preaching, Joseph seems to have died, because he's not mentioned any further in the scriptures. Only Mary seems to accompany Jesus. But it's interesting, from the very time of the Annunciation, Joseph is the one who seems to lead everything that happens. He decides. He takes the action. He takes it immediately, and it's always action based upon the call of God. So very, very much, he is the one who is caring for the child, the eternal Son of God, born into the world, born in as a tiny, vulnerable child who needed all sorts of care and protection and encouragement and teaching and training and formation. Joseph is the one to provide all of that. The Daughters of Charity look back to St. Vincent de Paul, and they have continued for century after century, year after year, bringing care and protection to people who need care, who need protection, who need assistance. They have done so, and they've done it without thought to their own comfort or safety, but only concerned for the well-being of the others. Vincent reminded them that if you want to be a true carer of other people, you must realize that in caring for them, you are caring, you are loving, you are serving God. See the face of Christ, he said, in those whom you are serving and caring. That was the advice of Vincent to the Daughters of Charity. St. Joseph is the one who shows us how to do that, because all that he did was loving, caring, serving for the actual child of God. He could see the presence of God. He knew the presence of God in his own child and in his blessed mother. Do not be afraid. What does Joseph say to us today? He seems to be very, very clear that Joseph is making a very clear, not a challenge, but a reassurance to those who have adopted him as their patron and leader, namesake. Listen to the word of God. Do all that you are doing, because it takes the prompting of God. Do not be afraid. Joseph took very radical decisions in the middle of the night to get up and take the child and his mother to a foreign country, to a hostile country, and to stay there. It seems to me, St. Joseph's, in the past you have taken very dramatic changes in the service that you offer, in the way in which it is offered, as we heard in the lovely history that was narrated for us at the beginning of this Mass. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to change. Don't be afraid to look differently, to find other things. You must allow God to continue to prompt you, to direct you, to change whatever needs to be changed. As the time passes, as society passes, as the situation in life passes, do not be afraid. Continue so that the care you provide will also change the ways provided, so that those in your care, those needing your support, will experience it more and more completely, because you are doing it under the guidance of St. Joseph. You are doing it in the way that you see and you realize, in caring for others, you are loving and caring the Son of God. Thank you.
very much to Father Paul for those words of reflection upon this happy occasion. We now turn to our bidding prayers, those who have prepared them. I would ask them now, please, to come forward. To the word of God, and I turn to our loving Father with all our prayers for our needs, the needs of the church, and the needs of the whole world.
For all leaders and communities of all faiths, except Pope Francis and Archbishop Leo, that they continue to lead us with wisdom and humility and respect for each other. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear us. Hear us. Thank you, Mike. Process of charity and attitude and care and respect. And St.Joseph, because this thing is good work and care. Lord, hear it.
Lord, hear us.
Thank you, God.
For the people who support, the staff, the trustees, and the whole family of St. Joseph's, that we continue to live out our Vincentian values in the spirit of community and friendship. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear us.
It's for all the members of St. Joseph's family who have gone to heaven that they enjoy laughter, happiness, and peace as they live on in our memories. Lord, help us.
Lord, hear us.
For peace in the world, that all the leaders of the power so the ever present matters and care them safely and the dearest. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear us.
For the future, that we look forward with hope that social justice will enable an increased level of choice and change, with more opportunity and equality for all. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear us.
Whenever we come to Mass, we always have special intentions in our hearts. Let's now place them in silence just for a moment upon the altar here before the Lord and ask him to listen to our prayer.
Lord,
our loving Father, listen to all those prayers that you make aloud and in the silence of our hearts and with the intercession of St. Joseph, grant us what is good for us. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Father, we
sacrifice and yours will be acceptable to God the Almighty. We pray, O Lord, that just as St. Joseph serves as loving care, your only begotten Son born of the Virgin Mary, so we may be worthy to minister with a pure heart at your altar. Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, and on the solemnity of St. Joseph to give you fitting praise, to glorify you and bless you. For this just man was given by you as spouse to the Virgin Mother of God, and set as a wise and faithful servant in charge of your household, to watch like a father over your only begotten Son, who was conceived by the overshadowing of the Holy Spirit, our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him the angels praise your majesty, dominions adore, and powers tremble before you. Heaven and the virtues of heaven and the blessed seraphim worship together with exaltation. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in humble praise as we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
The Lord, your church, spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Leo, our Bishop, and all the church.
Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, our spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Thank you.
thank you all for coming today and to this grace for leading St. Joseph's celebratory mass. We would like to invite you all over to the church hall for some refreshments and to give you the chance to catch up, to share some stories, and some of the people here may not know many others, others of you might know quite a few, but we all share St. Joseph's in common. So please mingle and meet friends, old and new. But before we go for tea, we do have a photographer, and we'd all be incredibly grateful if you could gather outside the church for a special centenary photograph. I hear that my eating career has grown, which is very impressive to St. Joseph's. Today has been a day of celebration for thanks and for reflection of all the things we have done and achieved over the last century. St. Joseph's exists to support people with a learning disability, and we remember and give thanks to everyone that we currently support and have previously supported, and for all the joy you've given us, and I think we've really seen it heaven today. It's truly a pleasure to see St. Matthew's filled with people we support, families, daughters of charity, trustees, staff, commissioners, and friends. Everyone at St. Joseph's is grateful to you all for coming to share on this historic occasion, and for the contribution you have made to St. Joseph's. We wouldn't be the service we are without each and every one of you. We give thanks to those who came before us, for those we have known and who are here today. We remember and celebrate you. We started today with a tableau on our values. Our values have been the guiding principle we have followed for the last 100 years as we have experienced so much change to models of care, who we've supported, who's worked with us, and through a world war and a pandemic. Whatever the future, our values will continue to keep us strong and guide our purpose. St. Joseph's has always been about community, with people at the heart of everything we do. Who knows what changes we'll see over the next 100 years, but we know without a doubt, however St. Joseph's looks, or whomever we support or works with us, the person will always matter. Thank you.
Matthew's for the nth time. This is almost like a home from home for St. Joseph's, and we're very grateful to everyone that's done that and made this liturgy beautiful. And well, we'll see if the bonfire lives up to the usual high standards. I'm sure it will. But I would like to just say a word of gratitude in particular to the Daughters of Charity. The Daughters of Charity came here 100 years ago, and I am sure they were made very welcome by my predecessor and by the predecessors of the people who used to sit here and that represented the Archdiocese when they first came here. But the Daughters of Charity have been around for a very long time, and they've had their ups and they've had their downs. When it came to the French Revolution, the Daughters of Charity, very recognisable as they were, they were taken away and stood up against the wall and shot for doing nothing more than what they do today, which is to be inspired by the charity of Christ on the cross to do what they do, to make of the gospel not a lot of words, but a actions. Actions. But actions that speak louder than words. And that continues to this day. And so my heart and my prayers go especially to the Daughters of Charity who stand here today, some of whom worked in St. Joseph, which are most of you, many of you, and to express a word of profound gratitude for the work that they have done and the burdens that they continue to bear today, right now, and which must be sometimes very difficult for them. So many thanks, many congratulations, and we will all be keeping you in our prayers with the deepest gratitude. Thank you. Defend with unfailing protection, O Lord, we pray, the family you have nourished with food from this altar, as they rejoice in the solemnity of St. Joseph, and graciously keep safe your gifts among them, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.